want to welcome everyone to the Mary Duke Biddle Trent Semans Center for Health Education. I'm Nancy Andrews, Dean of the Duke University School of Medicine and Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs. I'm so pleased to have so many friends, faculty, staff, students, and alumni to help us celebrate this great occasion. As I was walking around before, people kept saying congratulations, but it's really congratulations to all of us. This is a huge day for our school. Finally, we have a building that through its prominent location, stunning architecture, and visual connection to Duke University truly reflects our commitment and reverence for our mission of educating future leaders in medicine and science. It is indeed a great day for Duke University School of Medicine. We're thrilled to have our new home named for Mary Semans, and we are honored to be forever associated with the love she embodied for her fellow man, for her community, and for all things Duke. At this time, I would like to take a moment to recognize our distinguished guests and thank them for being with us. We are pleased to have several special friends here today. City of Durham Mayor, the Honorable William Bell. Is Mayor Bell here? He's coming. Hope he's not having trouble parking. Members of the Duke University Board of Trustees, Duke University Health System Board of Directors, and Duke Medicine Board of Visitors. Former Chancellors, Dr. William Anlian and Dr. Ralph Snyderman, and former Dean of the School of Medicine, Dr. Sandy Williams. Thank you for being with us today. We're here in this spectacular new facility today thanks to the generosity of the Duke Endowment, which in 2008 granted the largest gift in the history of our school so that we could begin planning a new home for medical education at Duke. Members of the Duke Endowment Board of Trustees and staff who are here are wearing white ribbons, and I'd like to ask them to please stand to be recognized. Joining the Duke Endowment, many alumni, friends, faculty, and staff have also given generously, and I want to thank all of you. Together, we succeeded in raising nearly all of the cost of this building from philanthropy. I want to give a special shout out to our students who raised enough funds to name two advisory deans' meeting rooms, and to their parents who also supported the building. This building reflects a great deal of care and planning by our Vice Dean for Education, Dr. Ed Buckley, along with Colleen Grakowski, Stacy McCorrison, Kate Paiva, Greg Warwick, Reba Brennan-Wagner, Clinton Miller, Monty Brown, and Sean Sebasic, who invested countless hours to ensure that every detail is just right. This building also mirrors the creativity and talent of its architects, Duda Payne of Durham, as well as the SLAM Collaborative, and Stewart Incorporated. I would like to thank them for their partnership in creating such an innovative and beautiful building on what was a very challenging site. Our students have been involved in planning from the beginning, and their presence today speaks volumes about their appreciation for and pride in this new home. As you can see from the display outside this hall, Mary Duke Biddle Trent Semans was our link to Duke University's founding family. The generosity and vision of her great uncle, James Buchanan Duke, created Duke Hospital and the schools of medicine and nursing, and also established the Duke Endowment to support children, healthcare, education, and rural churches in North and South Carolina. Mary served the Duke Endowment for many years as trustee, vice chair, and chair, and the trustees elected to create a permanent legacy for her by naming this building in her honor. We are pleased and honored to have many members of Mary's family, the Trent Semans family, here with us today. They are wearing blue ribbons. Will the Trent Semans family members please stand and be recognized? Mary was just 18 and a junior at Duke University when she married Josiah Trent, a member of our founding faculty and the first chief of the Division of Cardiothoracic Surgery. Mary became an integral part of the School of Medicine, volunteering in the Medical Center Library, and she was beloved by the faculty, the medical students, and the staff. Mary and Joe Trent had four children before his untimely death from lymphoma. She later married James Semans, a Duke surgeon and urologist, with whom she had three children. Mary maintained a very special relationship with the School of Medicine throughout her life, and she generously supported many different aspects of medical education here at Duke through her own personal philanthropy and that of the Mary Duke Biddle Foundation and the Duke Endowment. She was a friend to many, and she touched the lives of people throughout Duke University and Duke Medicine from our founding until today. Her spirit lives in this building, in its soaring, light-filled spaces, the feeling of community and collegiality it engenders, its commitment to excellence and innovation, and the closer connection it creates with Duke University. A common thread that connects our history in the School of Medicine, Mary embodied it in the way she cared for her community, the arts, human rights, and her personal connection with everyone she met. Our founding dean, Dr. Wilbert C. Davison, embodied this spirit as well. He was a student and lifelong friend of the great English humanist physician, Sir William Osler, a physician who called teaching medical students our most useful and important work. Osler also famously encouraged his fellow physicians not to take themselves too seriously and to have an avocation, some intellectual pastime, which may keep you in touch with the world of art, of science, or of letters. This same spirit is evident in our unique medical curriculum, commitment to lifelong learning and science, and the spirit of collegiality and collaboration that our alumni recall when thinking back to their medical school days. This building represents a rededication of our school and this institution to our students, our faculty, and to education, a renewal of that spirit of humanism which shaped our past and will carry us forward. Thank you all very much. At this time, I'm pleased to welcome Richard Broadhead, president of Duke University. Dick has been a terrific partner as we've grown our medical campus. Under Dick's leadership, we have advanced interdisciplinary partnerships across the university and expanded partnerships for global research, service, and education. Dick, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you, Nancy. It is said in proverbial wisdom that you can't make a silk purse out of a sow's ear. But I would reflect that that's just not so. You can make even better than a silk purse out of a sow's ear, but you need certain things. One of them is imagination, and another is help. First, as for imagination, people keep alluding to what the site of this building used to be like. But let's stop and remember, in case there's anyone here who never went here before. There used to be a road that kind of snaked off Research Drive and went nowhere in particular. It was what is meant by the phrase cul-de-sac, dead end, the road to nowhere. But from the road to nowhere, you could see at least one thing, namely the gleaming coal pile, which patients could also see out some hospital windows, and which, of course, made it possible for a train track to run right in front of the hospital and rumbling trains to come down and fill the coal pile. I saw the early siting of this building, and I remember even coming to the groundbreaking, remember? And all I could say was, I sure hope somebody knows why this is a good place to put this building. And now we come back and we find that actually that was just unimaginative of me. With imagination, someone could see what could have been on this site that never would have been there if someone wasn't able to envision it. What do we have now? the former hideous features of the landscape have been turned into scenic ruins. You will admire as you go upstairs, the former coal pile has now become, it looks like a Tintern Abbey or something, like the ruins of a former coal factory. No one will even know what that was in the future. Duke doesn't use coal anymore, you know. And so there it is, a sort of scenic little found feature of the landscape. Then there's something else we have, the beautiful openness of this site, and then just this amazing thing that the architects and siters have done, which is to make this not just a beautiful object in the university, but to make it a place of connectivity for the whole of the university. This site used to be connected to nothing. That's what a dead end is, the road to nowhere. Instead, when you stand here, you look up, you see the cancer center, you see the hospital, you see nursing, you see the whole continuum of physical care and training. You look down the hill and you see research, and you understand that research and the training and education are actually connected to each other now, literally. And then you can look past those buildings to the engineering buildings, to the environment buildings. And then at the very top of the hill is just a fantastic feature of this building that it gives you the sight of Duke Chapel from almost every time you look around. So it enables you to see medical education as part of the whole of the university. Just every time you move through the space, you get a lesson in connectivity, a lesson in the meaning of things. So that's one thing that was imagined, but even that is not the best thing that was created by the architects and designers of this building. Above all, what they did is to create the message, we care. In my childhood, it was said of Hallmark cards, they're what you send when you cared enough to send the very best. And I think this building says that, doesn't it? We care enough to send the very best people out to be the healthcare workers of the future. And we not only want good people, we want to give them the training that enables them to be the very best healthcare workers they could possibly be. And so here's a building, things we couldn't have even gotten right 5 years ago that have to do with technology, with simulation, with the work of teams, the whole principles of education as it emergingly becomes visible, those things can all be practiced here from the first. You know, Duke has a campaign underway. If you haven't heard of this, I'll give you a gift form. The campaign is based on the idea, this university isn't done. The whole posture of this university is forward. We're still looking how to do things better, how to more fully realize our promise. And especially that campaign is based on the notion, a university's great gift to the world are the trained talent we put out for the important careers that our world most needs. And what we want in that campaign is to make Duke a leading force in giving people the best training we can give them today, not just the training that was given 50 years ago, but building on that, the best training that could be given today so that people can most fully live up to their promise in the future. I believe if anyone scratched their head and said, what exactly does that mean? I could take them to this building and they would need no further explanation. Here it is embodied here. That's the imagination. And now for the help. Nancy gave credit to a bunch of names, and I thank all of those people by extension, architects, people who worked on the planning, people who worked on the curricular spaces, all of those things. I would add Nancy to the list, I would add Sandy, everybody who's been part of the medical leadership. But when I finish that list, I'm on my way to getting to the people who are at the heart of my thanks, which is the Duke Endowment, whose trustees sit in front of us. We all are thinking of Mary today. It's the time of year when we think of Mary. Wasn't it about a year and 2 weeks ago that Mary died? Well, it was about this time last year that we gathered to celebrate her. But you know, one thing you can say about Mary, and Nancy, your brief biography did underline the fact, Mary loved doctors. The only people she ever married were doctors. She loved doctors. She loved the doctors she literally loved. She loved all doctors by extension. And if there's one other category of people I think you could say Mary loved students. It's why she loved university. She loved the shaping of the talent for the future. And so what a great place to symbolize her legacy to this university, a place that's about doctors and about students and about how you turn one into the other. The trustees of the Duke Endowment, I remember the day when this gift was announced. It seems long ago now, doesn't it? And we had a long way to go to visualize how to make this promise come true, but today we're here. And I just thought I would cite one phrase from the indenture that Mr. Duke wrote when he gave the gift that you are the trustees of. You remember he said, "I advise that the courses at this institution be arranged first with special reference to the training of preachers, teachers, lawyers, and physicians, because they are most in the public eye, and by precept and example, can do the most to uplift mankind." This is a place that's for the training of physicians, not only because they're in the public eye, but because of what they can do to uplift mankind. Don't you feel, you guys, that you actually got it about right this time? You know, to you for your great gift, and to all who've helped to realize it, and to all of you who will live up to the promise of this building. And I walked around here the first second day of classes. Everybody was already acting as if they lived here for years, you know? Anyway, just to everyone who made this happen, what a happy day, and what a lucky university to have this building here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dick. At this time, I'd like to introduce our Chancellor for Health Affairs and President and CEO of the Duke University Health System, Dr. Victor Zhao. Victor has continued to be one of our strongest cheerleaders as we have moved forward in the expansion of this medical campus. He understands that buildings alone do not make a school great. Rather, it's the students and faculty who learn and work in these buildings who truly make the institution great. Victor, I appreciate your commitment to this amazing effort. Would you please come forward to say a few words?
Thank you, Nancy. It's a privilege to be here. This is a very special occasion. Just think, this is the first new building dedicated to medical education at Duke since the founding and the creation of the Davidson Hall, 1930, 83 years ago. And isn't this spectacular? You know, I'm just so thrilled to join you in renewing our commitment to our teachers and learners. It is through our educational mission that we have the greatest impact on the future of medicine, science, and health. I too want to say a special thank to our great friends at Duke Endowment for making this wonderful facility possible. Thank you very much. And for honoring the legacy of our dear friend, Mary Trent Semans, in such a special way as articulated by Dick Broadhead and Nancy Andrews. It's heartwarming to have so many also of Mary's family here. And I too thank you for the warm support and love you have for this institution. I'm also grateful to our friends here and the alumni, faculty, staff, and of course the students who's been a great part of this effort. Now, I want to have this opportunity to tell you a couple of stories. Two stories about the planning of this building. For a long time, you know, many people have dreamed about the building. And this afternoon, we heard from Sandy, Ralph Snyder, and others about dreaming having an education building. But it was back in the 75th anniversary celebration of Duke Medicine, 2005, when Sandy then was the dean, and we invited all these dignitaries to come and visit us to give a great symposium. And a number of Nobel laureates got in the cab and say, "Take me to Duke School of Medicine." And taxi driver says, "Where?" There's no address for School of Medicine. And Sandy, you remember our conversation saying, "We need a signature building to have an address." And that started this whole idea that, in fact, we should plan such a building. Now, of course, in order to build such a building, you need resources. So we went to the usual sage, got the sage advice of Bill Elliott and Mary Semans. And they thought it was important for the school to finally have a modern state-of-art facility, one that reflected the quality of medical education at Duke. And they agree with our aspiration. The rest, of course, was a planning process by which you can say, well, how do we approach the Duke Endowment? And of course, it culminated, as many of you will remember, in meeting here, right here, in fact, at the Davidson building and in the Duke Hospital. And what we did, because mine is sure, Russ Robinson, many others. What we showed them was where Duke, one of the top schools of medicine in the country, was educating our medical students. I think they were truly shocked when they were looking at the building. They thought there were these great rooms, etc. And of course, they found on the fourth floor of Davidson Hall chalkboards, tiny student lounge. And of course, the school medicine staff saved one of the old chairs. They had tennis balls on the legs to keep from scratching the linoleum floor in Duke South. Russell just told me, he said, if I may quote you, how the hell does a world-class university have a facility like this? So as they say, the rest is history, as you say. And of course, we remember greatly that day at the McGovern Center Children's when you announced that wonderful gift you gave to us. And I hope all of you see that we've put it to good use. So there was a lot of discussion where we should place the building. That's my second anecdote. And Sandy and I were thinking, Davidson Hall, where the history was, maybe we could just attach it right there to Davidson Hall. But Ed Buckley came and said the students wanted right here. They wanted right here because it was located right at the interface of education, research, clinical care. And of course, they're right. So as we thank the architects and the designers, we really have to thank the student for their foresight in seeing what critically important this place is in creating such a building. To your right is the research drive, where in fact all those, your left, all the research buildings where we have great research going on. To the left, in fact, is the now, of course, the Duke Hospital, but also Duke Pavilion, Cancer Center, and next door is the library. So I think this is the epicenter of our campus, and I think they chose well in terms of thinking about where it should be. It put medical education where it belongs, at the heart of everything that we do. And I truly believe that Mary would be very, very pleased. So it is fitting that the Mary Duke Biddle Trent Semans Center for Health Education is located at the heart of our revitalized campus. And you know, we really have the wisdom of our medical students to thank for that decision. So if Mary were here today, I know that she would be thrilled to see this building, and she would be personally touched that her fellow trustees named it in her honor. Of course, she would be so touched by the members of the family who are all here. For Mary believed in every aspect of our mission, research, patient care, and education. She could be counted at every turn, and I know that. I know Ralph knows that, and many of us know that, to be a champion and advocate for Duke Medicine. And of course, we are forever grateful to her. We miss her. So with that, this time I'd like to introduce Myna Shaw. It's my great pleasure, Madam Chairwoman of Duke Endowment, to say a few words. Myna, if I can introduce you.
Thank you very much, Victor. I appreciate that. And I had the privilege of being here about a month ago and spent a wonderful day with Victor and Nancy and Catherine Gillis and the whole team. And I was so excited to be able to see this building. And now to be here a month later, it's fabulous, and you all have been working very hard in a month. On behalf of the trustees and the staff of the Duke Endowment, I want to say how pleased we are to be here today to honor Mary Semans. It's been a little bit over 1 year since Mary passed away, and we at the Duke Endowment continue to be and will always be inspired in our work as we remember Mary's commitment and her passion for healthcare and medical education. Mary became a trustee of the Duke Endowment in 1957, and she served as our first female chairman of the Duke Endowment from 1982 to 2001. And in 2007, we celebrated Mary's 50th anniversary on the board of the Duke Endowment. As we all know, and it's been reiterated here today, Mary had a particular interest in healthcare, and she served on our healthcare committee at the Duke Endowment for over 3 decades and was a tremendous influence on that committee. Since its inception in 1924, the Duke Endowment has been committed to improving health and health care in the Carolinas. We know that our founder, James B. Duke, and Mary Semans would be so proud to see this fabulous state-of-the-art building. As North Carolina, South Carolina, and also other states try to grapple with the challenges and also the issues of health care reform, we are all wise, as been said here today, we are all wise to put our resources and invest in medical education, strong leaders and innovators who will be architects of health care for the future. We believe that naming this facility for Mary Semans honors her strong ties to this university and pays a fitting tribute to her remarkable life. My Duke Endowment colleagues and I are so proud to support the Mary Duke Biddle Trent Semans Center for Health Education. Thank you very much to everyone who has helped make this possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Minor. It's now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Ed Buckley, a graduate of this medical school and our Vice Dean for Medical Education.
This building is the culmination of hundreds of hours of meetings, planning sessions, and brainstorming. We included faculty, staff, administrators. All in all, over 100 people contributed to the planning. We spent many meetings asking, where is medical education going? What kind of structure will we need now and in the future to innovate and do things differently? And the architects kept asking us, what is the program? What is it you actually want to do in the building? At the end of the day, it wasn't very clear what we'd be doing 20 years from now, let alone of how much of what we would need. And we didn't want to screw it up. So we decided that we needed spaces that were flexible, multi-dimensional, and reconfigurable. So as you walk around after this meeting, note the walls move, the furniture is not fixed, the tables are sized to be changed to the activity at hand. Even this room that you're in right now can be divided into smaller rooms. There's a track which runs up here, so this can be divided down. There's a track which runs down there, it can be divided down. And you notice that the walls come up to expand out into the antrum. We did settle on some basic things. We needed space for interactive and team learning, and on the second floor you'll notice an auditorium which is set up for that very purpose. We needed a space that could accommodate large meetings, hence this floor. We needed some space for simulation, and you'll see that on the fifth floor along with clinical skills. And we needed a place other than that seventh floor little place in Davison Building for the students to be. And we now have a nice open space on the fourth floor, which you'll see. And we needed study space, and space where people could just gather. And as you walk around, notice the little cubby holes, antrums, and furniture that's placed throughout the building on each of the floors, where people can just sort of gather and interact with each other. And the other thing that we wanted was visibility. Not only looking out, as you'll see, there's a lot of glass, especially on the south wall, but we also wanted the visibility for looking in. We wanted the people out there to see that there were things going on in here. And as Dr. Zhao implied, before we were sort of invisible, and I wanted people to see the building being used and to want to come and join us and not hide behind closed doors. I was listening to NPR one day a few weeks ago when we were getting ready to move into this building, and a famous architect had just passed away, and they were doing a tribute to her. And one of the quotes that they attributed to her was that buildings are important, that they really do set the tone for the activity that's at hand. And then extraordinary buildings are a gift. I think this is an extraordinary building and an extraordinary learning place and a very wonderful gift. So I personally want to thank the Duke Endowment, the Hare family, and the rest of you who contributed to this creation. Each floor has its own personality and functionality, as you will see as you walk around. The other thing that this building has is the architects wanted to make sure this had a LEED status. LEED is a green type building. This building has a silver status. And it extends not only to the building itself, but as you look out the window, you'll see the promenade that's being, Esplanade as we call it, is being developed. And that esplanade is created to filter the rainwater from the other buildings, major buildings around the place. And by the time the rainwater supposedly gets out at the bottom, it's pretty clean. And so that's not just a green space, but it's actually a very artistic filter for the rainwater that comes off the buildings. So I work personally, and this is a little bit redundant because it's already been done, but I've worked so hard with these folks that I personally want to thank the architects and staff who put in, who put our vision for all those hours into a reality. Teron Duda from Duda Payne, Bob Polito and Mary Jelinek, Ray Weaver and Sydney Ward of the SLAM Collaborative, the folks here at Duke, Greg Warwick, Rebo Ragnar, and Sean Zubek. And also the folks that actually made those instructions a reality, and the project managers from Balfour Beatty were Brian Berger and Clayton Semans. There is an unsung hero who shepherded this project through, who fought for this location, even though the students wanted this location to be here. When I originally came back to the powers that be and said, I think we'd like the location to be next to the library, they said, no way. Absolutely no way. Said, that's health system. Health system's going to expand into that place, and it was not going to happen. There was one individual who was a little bit tenacious, and he fought for that position and eventually came back and said, we're going to put the building right next to the library, and that was Monty Brown. So I don't know if Monty's in the crowd here, but if he is, thank you very much, Monty, for doing it. I also want to thank my education team who worked many extra hours for the fine details that you'll see. There were colors, there were fabrics, there were how much, of what kind, and where. The decisions were endless. And they've already been articulated, but they are Stacy McCorson and Colleen Grahowski, Clinton Miller, Amy Ward, and there are actually too many more to mention, but they know who you are, and I'm very, very appreciative for all the efforts. And lastly, there was one person who lived this project 24/7, 365. She was my eyes and ears and was sort of the midwife of this baby. And she, I own a special sense of gratitude, and that is Kate Pilot. Kate, are you here? If you are, stand up. Okay, she was working anxiously to try to make this event happen this evening. I mentioned earlier how important the students were in their planning process, and I want to thank them and their families who contributed to the building, and a special thanks to Phil Lehman, who helped launch the student fundraising event, the Davidson Council, and the medical student body for all their support. And lastly, I personally want to thank each and every one of you who contributed to this generous vision to make this a reality. It's very, very appreciated. Now I'd like to introduce Navid Potihari, a fourth-year medical student and former president of the Davidson Council, who was very involved in the planning and student fundraising for the building. Navid.
So I've never really used this script to say anything, but actually very nervous. And chancellors, I don't know if you can write me a script for some beta blocker. I'm going to pass out right now. So I'm very honored to be here today to speak on behalf of all of the current and future learners who will be spending part of their lives in this building. And to say thank you to all of the administrators who were very thoughtful, as well as the generous donors who could help make this building possible. And to reiterate something that my grandmother used to tell me, when you're saying thanks, it's good to know what you're thankful for. So let me repeat sort of the magnitude of what is happening here. This wondrous building is built upon once which there once was a coal pile. And it features a curriculum that was taught out of a basement. And so as a senior medical student here, I could say that even with the facilities we had when I started, these have been the most enjoyable, enriching, and formative years of my adult life. And so I can only imagine what this perfect building will now do for the education of everyone to come. And because the first year medical students have spent most of the time in this building since it is open, I'd like to quote some of their words. Though it is difficult to speak for the entire student body, we are confident that this building means home. It means quiet. It means our own space that is perpetually happy, bright, and energizing. It is now our favorite spot to socialize, plan, eat, relax, laugh and enjoy the difficult yet rewarding process that is Duke Medical School. This building now houses the experiences and memories that will comprise our journey. It is the platform on which we are taught and equipped to move out into Duke North, the research laboratories, the VA, back to Duke South, and into the community. Therefore, this building is the axis for all those spokes, central both in location and purpose. What else makes this building special? As our country now prepares itself for a healthcare revolution, let us not underestimate the impetus for change that is being pressed upon the future of medical education. Flexibility, innovation, and efficiency are now the new non-negotiables for medical schools across the country. And as a national leader in this movement, Duke has promised to serve as an example of how to embrace this requisite change and model it for the rest of the world. This building embodies that promise. Its four outer walls may be fixed, but inside it is a living building that has the capacity to change itself to meet the demands of future learners for generations to come. And our gratitude for this building will be expressed in the smiles that you see here every day. To conclude our thanks, I would like to make a statement to the late Mrs. Trent Semans and to her lovely family. I remember meeting Mrs. Semans at the Medical Alumni Awards banquet in 2011. It was heartwarming to see the many guests greet and embrace her. So many lives have been enriched by her presence at Duke and in this community. So it is only fitting that her wonderful legacy be joined with this wondrous building. Mrs. Semans, I know that you can see us, and I know that you can hear me. I hope that we've made you proud with this magnificent tribute to you and your vision for tomorrow's physicians. As a lady of North Carolina, you can appreciate that this building has many windows. For us to not see just the beauty of a sunlit North Carolina day, but also the brightness of a starlit North Carolina night. There are rooms here where people will gather to socialize and share ideas. Rooms where lives will be changed through the power and magnificence of learning. Rooms where memories will be created for decades to come. In every classroom, in every office, and every conference room, your spirit and presence will be felt. In 1983, you asked the Duke graduating class for an extraordinary devotion to humanity. As future healthcare providers, we will honor your wishes. There is an old saying, home is where the heart is. This is our new home, and your heart, which you gave so selflessly to this institution, will never be forgotten. We honor you with a building that bears your name, and every day we enter this building, your strength, your humanism, your sweetness, and your values will help remind us of what we expressed in our applications to come here, our promise to make a difference. Thank you for making Duke better. Thank you for making us better. Thank you very much.
Adjust the mic down. Thank you, Navid. At this time, I would like to invite Mrs. Mary Trent Jones, the eldest daughter of Mary Duke Biddle Trent Semans, to say a few words.
Thank you, Nancy. This is a great building. On behalf of my sisters and our brother, I'm honored to represent the Trent Semans family. Mom would have been thrilled to be here today. This building and its mission to educate leading doctors and medical professionals and scientists is a wonderful tribute to her life and her dedication to making the world a better place for all. She came of age within this great Duke University community. She took the aspirations of her great-grandfather, Washington Duke, her grandfather, Benjamin N. Duke, and her great uncle, James B. Duke, to heart and made them her own. I know that she was very proud of Duke Medicine's commitment to James B. Duke's dream of better health for all people in the Carolinas and beyond. Our mother had what some people call an extravagant love for Duke. We all in a family, she talked about Duke constantly. This love was returned by many times over by the people from every area of the campus. But she also had a strong spirit of determination and she challenged those around her to always work harder and accomplish more. We hope that her extravagant love will nurture this community, the brilliant, hardworking, and idealistic students, and the dedicated, talented faculty. May you care for one another and embrace all of life in the way that she did. May her presence also serve as a constant reminder to you to never stop pushing boundaries in your quest to make the world a healthier place for all people. Many years ago, Mom was asked what she thought James B. Duke would say about Duke today. And she said, "He'd probably say, 'I am so grateful for all that's been done.' And he'd probably say, 'Just keep on going. Keep on fulfilling the vision. Never let it stop.'" On behalf of the Trent Semans family, we wish to thank the Duke Endowment for honoring our mother's legacy. And we wish great success for the future of Duke University School of Medicine. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Well, you can probably tell that we've gotten to the end of the chairs now. So it's now a very special time. We're going to unveil a portrait of Mary Semans, which will hang in the west entrance of the building. I'd like to invite the staff hands to help remove the chairs. As they start to do that, I would also like to invite all seven of Mary's children up to the stage. Mary Jones, Rebecca Kirkland, Sally Trent Harris, Barbara Kimbrell, Jenny Kortbujan, James Semans, and Beth Hubbard. Feels like she is right here, right now. Before we close the program, I'd like to let you know that our students have invited you to stay and tour the building as our prospective students do when they visit. You've heard about this building's unique features, and now it's time to see for yourself. Students will be stationed throughout the building to help introduce you to special areas. You'll find wine and hors d'oeuvres in locations everywhere on every floor, and we invite you to take a self-guided strolling tour. When you're on the second floor, be sure to stop and see the beautiful display honoring donors to the building. And now, to close our program, I'd like to introduce Duke Medicine's own student a cappella group. These students balance the fast-paced curriculum, responsibilities of clinical rotations, and pursuit of scholarly interests, all while making time for music practice. Please welcome Major Groove.
Bum, ba-dum, ba-dum, bum, ba-dum, ba-dum, bum, ba-dum, ba-dum, bum. luncheon from 12 to 1, eating at Nudge. Just look at the menu, wow, what choices we've got. It suddenly hits you that this building is really grand,
and this could be the start of something really hot.
This dedication's an exciting day in history.
But now that Tish is here, just think of what those kids will say. I know that this is where I'll find my dough.
You're studying red blood cells, the plural. We're looking at internships in neurology. Look up from those histoslides and put down those Netters guides. Cause this could be the start of something big.
You could miss the start of something very big. So come and play. You'll see.
This could be the start of something wonderful. Why don't you come along and join in this fun song? You'll see.
You once were a med student, so now you're a doctor. You're seeing a patient when you start to recall. This could be the start of something. This could be the heart of something. This, yes, it's the start of something big, really big.
Class dismissed.